A year ago, after installing solar panels and batteries on my Berlingo, car camping has indeed become much more convenient, and I've achieved energy independence. Since the installation, I've hardly removed the battery from the car for charging. However, the rigid solar panels require some space and a more complex mounting method, so it took considerable effort and assistance from others during the installation process. As I often travel to the factory in China for business, where I also have an SUV, I plan to install solar panels on it as well, considering that this SUV has a lower roof height, resulting in less available space on the roof. And with my colleagues at the factory all on holiday, no one is available to help. I want to maintain a consistent no-build-build style. And with only 2 days left before the departure time for a long trip, I still have doubts about whether we can start the journey smoothly. Recently, I purchased two thin film solar panels with dimensions of 800 by 670 millimeters. I chose thin film solar panels because, unlike rigid solar panels that need to maintain a certain thickness, thin film solar panels use only a single layer of extremely thin photovoltaic material, making them lighter and thinner. Moreover, they use flexible substrates, making them easier to conform to the shape of a car. Other advantages of thin-film solar panels include minimal power loss for the same shaded area and decent performance under low-light conditions. With advancements in technology, their conversion efficiency is also approaching that of rigid solar panels. I decided to use them for the stealth modification of my SUV. My initial idea was to directly adhere the two thin-film solar panels to the bottom of the panoramic sunroof. However, experiments showed that this approach significantly reduced the solar panel's efficiency, forcing me to abandon this idea. So, I looked online for other people's mounting methods. Some people use silicone to directly attach the solar panels to the roof, but when it comes time to remove the panels, silicone can only be scraped off and might damage the car paint, making it a destructive modification. Others drill holes in the roof to secure the solar panels, which doesn't align with my no-build-build modification philosophy. Some use adhesive tape to stick the solar panels around the edges to the roof, but considering the tape might become brittle or detached due to sunlight exposure and the unappealing aesthetics, I couldn't adopt this method either. After finding that none of the online methods suited me, I re-examined the SUV's roof to find the best solution for myself. The SUV's roof has a sunroof composed of two glass panels, one fixed and one that can be raised and slid back using the car's controller. I plan to attach the two thin-film solar panels separately to these two sunroof glass panels, reducing sunlight penetration into the car while retaining the sunroof's functionality. So, I measured the dimensions of the SUV's sunroof to ensure they match the dimensions of the two thin-film solar panels. Next, due to my concerns about securing the panels, I plan to implement a triple anti-detachment measure. The first layer involves using traceless nano-adhesive to attach the solar panels to the car's sunroof glass. Because nano-adhesive has one side with a fixed-type backing adhesive and the other side with countless tiny suction cup-like structures, when the suction area is sufficient, it provides corresponding tensile strength. To remove it, simply peel it off gradually from the edges without leaving any traces, making it an ideal material for non-invasive modifications. Second layer, sunroof clamps. I'll use a piece of thin plastic sheeting to adhere to the front edge of the solar panel. By closing the car's sunroof, I'll secure the solar panel by clamping the plastic sheeting, preventing the nano adhesive from failing due to high temperatures. The final safety measure involves threading a rope through the small holes around the solar panel and tying it to the roof rack. This way, even if the first two methods fail, the solar panel will at least be tethered to the roof, preventing it from falling onto the road and affecting traffic safety. Next, I'll proceed with the solar panel installation. First, I'll extend and expand the front ends of the two solar panels using a layer of plastic sheeting and secure them with transparent tape on both sides. Then, I'll cut the nano adhesive into strips to prepare for fixing around the solar panel's perimeter. When sticking, I'll carefully position and adjust the edge's distance and ensure that the extended plastic sheeting has enough area to be clamped by the car's sunroof. When the extended plastic sheeting folds into the car's interior, I'll secure it under the glass sunroof for added safety and aesthetics. Additionally, I need to secure the wiring while leaving some slack between the solar panels to prevent the wires from being overly stretched when opening the sunroof. I'll extend the battery's wiring through the gap of the car's tailgate into the interior and protect it with heat shrink tubing. After completing these securing steps and before officially charging, I wanted to test if this approach might cause any concerns about water leakage on the roof. So, I drove my car to a service car wash to conduct the test. Seeing the car wash machine with large brushes moving from both sides and the top, I began to worry about whether the brushes might hit the solar panel's wiring during the wash. However, it turned out that the brushes did not cause any movement to the solar panels, and the wiring remained intact. More importantly, when the sunroof was fully closed, there was no sign of water leakage inside the car. Basically, this setup should allow me to embark on my journey with peace of mind. After completing the first and second layers of securing measures, I'm quite confident that the solar panels won't detach. Therefore, I decided to skip the third layer of hole piercing and fixing. I'm planning a 5,000 km long-distance road trip this time, while also testing my power system. In addition to the 100-watt solar panels connected in series, I also equipped a 2.5 kWh lithium iron phosphate battery. The appliances I'll be using on the road include a 100-watt electric kettle, a 180-watt electric cooker, a 300-watt electric stove, and other USB devices. Everything is ready, and I'm ready to hit the road. In the first few days of the journey, the weather was consistently bad, and the solar panels had virtually no power output. It wasn't until I reached Kunming, Yunnan, where the sun's intensity increased due to the higher altitude, that the solar panels' charging efficiency noticeably improved. Although I had prepared a backup battery charger in advance, there was no need to use it throughout the journey. However, when traveling on regular highways, the advantages of solar charging became evident. Any losses along the way could be replenished by solar power. Charging phones and computers, boiling water, and cooking relied on solar energy and the stored battery capacity. Basically, there was no worry about running out of power. The experience of installing the solar panel this time has provided some valuable insights. With the battery level at 83%, I used solar charging while cooking. By the next morning, the battery was fully charged again. This situation offers some valuable data. 1. Solar panel charging capability. Estimates suggest that a 200-watt solar panel can recharge my battery by approximately 750 watt-hours in a day, equivalent to a 200-watt solar panel generating at full power for 4 hours. This exceeded my expectations, possibly due to the vehicle's good heat dissipation while driving, ease of cleaning on a smaller vehicle, etc. This experiment also proved the feasibility of installing thin-film solar panels on the roof. 2. Daily power consumption and concept of car camping. Although solar charging is limited, having the correct power consumption concept can still achieve energy self-sufficiency. Balancing input and output, not using inverters, and maximizing charging during peak periods are crucial. Based on the appliance specifications, the total daily power consumption is about 700 to 800 watts, while the solar panels can meet these demands daily. Additionally, using rest stops or hotels for hot water and meals during the journey helps save energy. 3. Appropriate battery storage capacity. The size of the storage battery is directly related to the solar power generation capacity. The battery capacity should be greater than the solar charging capacity for one day. Otherwise, it would result in wasted solar power generation. Moreover, the battery capacity should not exceed the solar panel's 3 to 4 days of generation, as an oversized battery would increase fuel consumption and waste space during driving. My suggestion is, the storage battery capacity should be greater than the maximum daily generation capacity, and it should be able to be fully charged within 2 to 3 days. Taking a 200W solar panel as an example, the daily charging capacity is approximately 800W. Therefore, it's recommended that the battery capacity be greater than 800W and less than 2400W. Considering the balance between generation and consumption and the battery storage capacity, even if the daily consumption slightly exceeds generation, with a 2500Wh battery capacity, I can easily conduct car camping activities for over a week. The method of installing thin-film solar panels shared this time is simpler than the previous rigid panels, requiring only finding suitable flexible solar panels and using the sunroof as a fixing structure. Next, I plan to equip a solar system for my MPV in the United States, and I currently have no idea how to secure it, but I believe I'll find a solution eventually. Above is the sharing of installing the solar panel on the SUV this time. I hope you'll like it. Thank you.